Tell somebody.
Gotta tell somebody. I'm not ashamed to tell the world that you keep blessing me.
Yes. Hi, Leanne Cunningham. Ladybug, what's going on? Denise Merritt.
all the way from McDonald, Pennsylvania. Jim, good to see you. Sister Elaine, my girl, yes.
Come on, let me hear you say it.
Yes.
Say it
when I'm in trouble.
Woo!
That's my baby daughter. She's here with me today. Awesome. Too much sauce. Yes. I can't help myself. This is when I come to life, even in this time right now. Yeah, listen, I was just tell you what, you know, I was feeling. I don't know why today of all days. Yes, I'm doing this by myself, but I got these steady people that come in every week and they just support me. Mark Renee Miller, good to see you. And I looked over at the door. Somebody was knocking at the door. All the way from Georgia. She wrote in just for this. But I gotta love her. Gotta love her. Gotta love her. Gotta love her. Y'all ready? Sharon Snatchko, what's going on? All the way back from The View. Thank you for jumping on. I hope you stay on. I swear I got something to tell you. I got a little something, something. Jesus Will. Anita Wilson is part of my play, my track that I use for when I'm out there walking and running and meditating on the Lord. And hey, keep on inviting people. Keep on clicking like, share, invite. Like, share, invite. Like, share, invite. How y'all this morning? Those of you who know me, I'm overseer, pastor, sister, whoever, Frieda Thorpe. Yes, overseer of RDK in Westland, Pennsylvania, 418 Westland Road, Westland, Pennsylvania, 15378. I got the 15378. We're at the 15378. Say what? 15378. I don't know where Roxy is. We had that down pat in the basement of the 15378. I got the 15378. All right, y'all. So here we go. Hi, Linda Carter. Good to see you. Good to see you. We are here this morning. Just quick announcements before I get started. RDK has been open, but we today, you know, the Lord is leading us just to leave it shut this morning. So there will not be any service at the location. But I'm glad you tuned in here because we're having church right here. All right. Yes, we're having church right here. And we're lifting God up right here in Cape Canaveral, Florida, live via Facebook. And I also want to give a shout out to, again, the Builders Church. It has already began virtual services, 4:30 on Facebook Live. Look them up. You got to like them and get the notification so you know that when they're coming on. Hey, it's a new, exciting ministry that if you are located in the Atlanta area, you need to get there quickly. Start with just getting online at 4:30 and you'll experience some of the Spirit of the Lord that is just captivated right there on the screen with you. Make sure you get on there and 4:30 today, 4:30 every Sunday, and she will let you know when the grand opening will be, when you'll be able to come through the doors. And we always say, the Lord willing, the crick don't rise. But if the Lord is willing, the crick won't rise. Amen? Ain't that a good thing? That's something I think maybe my mama told me. I'm not sure, Mom, how that worked. But nevertheless, also, I want to say on Tuesdays at 1 o'clock, we are on the telephone, teleconferences with all the good ladies from Metropolitan Missionary Baptist Church and women all across the world. You are welcome to get on. I will leave the number, and Sister Lynette, you're on there. Maybe you could type it in while we're talking. Love you too, Pat. Maybe one of you all could type it in and let people know how to come on to our teleconference on Tuesdays at 1 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. Well, we're just talking girl talk, y'all. If you're a girly girl, if you're trying to get to be a girly girl, get online. Let's talk a little bit. We're having church on Tuesdays for real. So today, Should I stay or should I go? Boom, 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 boom. Should I stay or should I go? That's the message for today. We're at the end of the series called The Cave Experience. And if you all have been with us throughout this experience, you will understand where we're going. Should I stay or should I go? That's usually a topic that we talk about in hurricane season, which it happens to be hurricane season. Right here in Florida, we haven't experienced anything, but that's the first thing we think of when the tornadoes and the hurricanes come. Should we stay or should we go? Should we hunker down, as the Floridians say, or should we go? Should we escape to wherever? Turn in your Bibles with me to 1 Samuel 22, 1-5, which has been our scripture that we have been reading from. 1 Samuel 22, 1-5. Okay, David at the Adullam and Mizpah. That's the topic of my section here that I'm reading. I'm reading from the New International Version of the Bible. Verse 1, David left Gath, escaped to the cave of Adullam. When his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him there, all those who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him, and he became their commander. About 400 men were with him. From there, David went to Mizpah in Moab and said to the king of Moab, "Would you let my mommy and daddy, my father and mother, come and stay with you until I learn what God will do for me?" We can't lead other people all the time until we figure out what God is saying to us. Good morning, sister brothers. You know I love you. I am so glad that you're able to get on here today. I know you've been through some medical things, but this lady right there is a survivor. Verse 4, so he left them with the king of Moab, and they stayed with him as long as David was in the stronghold. Verse 5, but the prophet Gad said to David, "Do not stay in the stronghold. Go into the land of Judah." So David left and went to the forest of Herath. Okay, good morning, Sister Elaine. Yes, there it is. That's where we're going to be on Tuesday at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Meet us there. So listen, here it is. On March 11, 2020, the coronavirus disease, better known as COVID-19, was declared a pandemic by the World Health Organization. And on March 13, 2020, a national emergency was declared in the United States concerning the COVID-19 outbreak. Let me pause for the cause. And I pray, but let me pray with y'all, because y'all know, y'all say, "Oh, she ain't saved. She's..." She didn't even pray. She didn't even, oh God, loose them right now in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you for just your presence here. I thank you for being in this building. Lord, even though it may not be a church as the world would see it, Lord God, it is your sanctuary of praise. It is your sanctuary of worship. It's a place where I've gathered, Lord God, with many faces online, Lord, to exalt your name, Lord God, to decree and declare what thus saith the Lord in this season. Oh God, we thank you for showing up where two or three are gathered together in your name. We thank you for showing up in the trouble. We thank you for showing up in disease. We thank you for showing up in COVID. We thank you for showing up in July the 5th, 2020. Thank you for showing up in Cape Canaveral. Thank you for showing up in our despair. Thank you for showing up in our distress. Thank you for showing up, oh God, when we don't know where to go, oh God. Thank you for showing up this morning, Lord God. Rapture us up into the place where we can hear you, where we can see you, we can know, Lord God, what your heart is towards your children, oh God. Lead us and guide us in all truth, oh God. Have your way right now, God, and we promise to give you the glory for this story in Jesus' matchless name. If you agree, right where you are, say amen. Amen, amen, amen. Pardon my disorganization this morning. Sometimes I get a little carried away. But yes, we're talking about COVID, and I'm still talking about COVID, and the world's still talking about COVID, and yes, indeed, I am still talking about the cave. How you doing, Jermaine? Hallelujah. In March, people were chased into isolation by an enemy that we couldn't even see. Have you ever ran from an enemy that you couldn't see? You knew the enemy was there, but you couldn't see it. This virus, even though we're told it's a virus, it's nothing that we can see. Not unlike the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, or that we know that the Holy Ghost abides, but we can't always see him, but we see the results. And that's what is going on with this enemy. We can't see the virus itself, hallelujah, as it sprouts out of people's mouths or transcends or transmits through handshakes and hugs and all of those things. But we know that it exists. We do know that it exists. It wasn't just anybody running to the cave. It was everybody running into isolation. It wasn't just the elderly that ran, but it was the rich. It was the poor. It was the business owners. Listen, it was the Section 8 recipients. It was the single mothers, the single fathers, the married mothers, the married fathers, the preachers, the teachers, the butcher, the baker, the candlestick makers, whatever and wherever your safety was, we ran to that thing. I don't know about you, but I ran to the rock. Hallelujah. I ran to the rock that is higher than myself. Hallelujah. Some of us ran to the cave called Adullam. This is where we've been, we put our pin in for these last few weeks. The cave of Adullam, where King David, y'all, giant slayer, bear berator, lion tamer, musician, worshiper, cup bearer, armor bearer, sheep herder, warrior over tens of thousands, he escaped to the cave of Adullam. His family ran to the cave, and then at least 400 men ran to the cave. We talked really about the men on Father's Day, but we're going to retract a little bit. Stressed men ran, broke men ran, dissatisfied, short men, tall men, skinny men, fat men, married men, single men, they ran to the cave. I want to believe that they were not, unlike David, chased into the cave, but I believe that these men were led to the cave. Many times we question God, how did I end up here? How did I end up in this place? It's dark and it's damp. It has no sparkle or rhinestones. It has no stainless steel appliances. It has hardwood floors, Brazilian chair to be exact. It has none of those things that we find for comfort. It had no chicken and dumplings burning on the stove. It had no cake in the oven. It was just a dark, damp place that they ran to. But I feel that I needed to be led into the cave. I felt something in that cave, in that place. Listen, I came limping, I came wounded, grieving, broke, busted, disgusted, but nevertheless, I came. I don't care how you get there, baby. Just get there if you can. Hallelujah. God has been beckoning some of you to the cave. Some of you have been here with me, and some of you are still on your way. God's still calling you by name. It doesn't make sense to go backwards. It doesn't make sense to go from the bright lights to the dark night lights. But God is beckoning you. People question why would you run from this to that? Why would you knowingly go to a hole in the side of a hill looking for answers? Why would you do that? Can I tell somebody why? I'm glad you asked that. Because you were led. You were led by the Holy Ghost. Some came from a mile away and some came 50 miles away, but you came nevertheless. You came solo, and some of you came by two. Some of y'all came just like in the ark. You came into the ark. It didn't smell good. It didn't look good. And surely I'm here to tell y'all, somebody, it don't feel good in the cave. Hallelujah. But this is the good news. It was a safe place.
Yes, Lord.
It was a safe place. And some of us are looking for God in all the wrong places because of what it looks like.
Wow.
But I'm telling you, there was safety in the cave. And when we talk about cave experience, it's indicative that we have unity when we come into the cave, because it's dark. in the cave. And you have people that come from every dysfunctional walk of life. And if we don't learn to unify right now, hallelujah, if you don't learn to unify right now, instead of coming out, a mighty army will come out fighting each other instead, fighting together against the enemy. That's what we should be doing. Wow, how do 400 men that are distressed, discontented, broke, busted, and disgusted all come together and end up walking to the same beat? The drum. How does that happen? Well, remember in the beginning of the series that we started on the cave experience, it is also on YouTube on my page. Please hit like and subscribe to my YouTube page, or go on any of Freda Thorpe Ministries or any of those so you can catch up where we are on today. But remember in the beginning of our series, those of you who have been walking along with us, we talked about Bruce Wayne and how he lived in the glitz and the glamour in Wayne Manor. But it wasn't until he went underground to the Batcave that he was transformed. And we begin to transform in the cave with all these other people. And sometimes it gets boring in the cave. Yes, indeed. And sometimes it gets tight and it gets irritating in the cave. In the cave, and we start to get used to the dark in the cave. It doesn't say that while these men were in the cave, listen, that they all got along. It didn't give us all the details of what happened in the cave. Testosterone was rising up probably in the cave, and he don't know where I came from, and he don't know who he's messing with. Besides, they train in the cave. And when it comes to training, y'all, and fighting and learning how to fight alongside each other, sometimes it gets to be personal. And we forget that it's just that. It's training. They went from weeping willows to warring warriors in the cave. And at times you just hate it in the cave. Yeah, you hate it in the cave. Our young people are always murmuring under their breath, I can't wait to get out of this house. You said it, and you said it, and you've said it, you've all said it. We've been in our parents' house so long. I can't wait to get out of this house. I can't wait and try to run the first chance that they get. And some go to college, listen, not because they want to get educated. They go to college to try to run out of the house. They get married, not because they're truly, totally upside down in love, but it's a way out. I don't know, not because I don't want training anymore. That's the bottom line. I don't want, because you know the Bible says for us parents that we're supposed to train a child in the way they should go, and when they get old, they don't depart. So you keep on training them until they get it. And you know when they got it, when they stop doing and making foolish, childish decisions, when they know to get up and go and worship, when they already know to abide by the laws of the Lord, when they already know and you ain't got to tell them, that's when the training stops. But some people fall short and they stop before they're completely trained, and they're loosed out in the world, and they're just messed up and jacked up. But they don't want no more training. I don't need no more training. Let me out. I want to get out. I don't know about you, but in the state of Florida, they could not wait to get out. And I know there's some of my fellow Floridians on this line, but that's the truth. If you look around, we could not wait to get out. We don't need anybody telling us that we can't do it. We make our own decisions. We just celebrated Independence Day after all, right? Correct? And so we watch our state climb higher and higher in the numbers of COVID. One day it went up 10,000. The next day it went up 11,000 people. The very next day, people say, well, a lot of it's because a lot more people are getting tested. Listen to what you're saying. I don't care how they're getting tested. These people have been affected by a disease that we could prevent in our lives. People, COVID be whipping our behinds, but we continue to be outside of the cave without any kind of armor on, without masks, without gloves. We don't wash our hands anymore because we've gotten tired of the routine already. We got tired of training ourselves. We're just coming out. I'm coming out. I want the work. You know, I go there. I'm sorry. Y'all know me. But you were
warned to stay in isolation. You don't have to be afraid of the enemy to get your behind beat. Ooh, I helped you right there. You ain't got to be scared to get your behind beat. I don't care how bold you are, you can still get that behind whoop. I remember hearing the mothers back in the day, they'd be whooping you and talking to you all at the same time. They'd have a hold of you like this, and they'd be, didn't I tell you not to go outside? Didn't I tell you? And God, he got us. He's holding on to us. Be whipping us all at the same time, and we still trying to get away. We still trying to get out the cave. We still trying to get away with no training. Wow. We still trying to get out and do our own thing, because it's my thing. You like Burger King. You want to have it your way. One of my dear acquaintances, and I love her to death, she said to me, Frieda, I know you're scared, but bless your heart, you know. But you know, she means very well. I just want you to say she loves me. She means very well, and she was trying to encourage me. But just because I'm staying 6 feet away and not hanging close to people and wearing a mask, don't get it twisted, y'all. This chick ain't scared. it's not my fear, it is wisdom. Hallelujah. Something down in my knower, something down in my heart says, listen, you have survived cancer, you have survived divorce, you have survived chronic asthma, kidney problems, all of those things. We ain't gonna let no virus take me out. I still got work to do in the kingdom. Now, if you wanna keep playing with it, you're gonna miss God. You're gonna miss God. You gotta pay attention and be okay with going against the grain. Be okay with being the only one in Publix with a mask on. Hallelujah. Be okay with walking into a restaurant with your mask on and everybody looking at you like, oh, she's scared. No, I'm wise. I listen to the voice of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So it's wisdom. Hear me, it's wisdom. So we're so grown though, we're dying. Oh God, we're so grown, we're dying. We're not just dying physically, you're dying emotionally, spiritually. We're just dying. Oh my God, that person you used to be, that shout you used to, oh glory, that dance you used to have, all of those things, you're dying inside because you left training way too early. If you'd have stayed in training, you'd have known how to put your sword up. You'd have known how to put your shield up. You'd have known when to march right, left, right, left. You'd have known what to do, when to march, how to march, when to stay, when to go. You would have understood that if you would have just stayed in training. There were so many issues in the cave, y'all. I'm not saying that it was just a little peaceful place and it was just beautiful and all that. There were issues in the cave. But the training in the cave, listen, kept the issues to a minimum.
Yes.
It kept it to a minimum. There was disease in the house, but when it got outside of the house, it started multiplying. Wow. Hear me? That's why the doctor's saying about COVID to stay. If you got any symptoms, stay in the house.
Wow.
We want to run. We got symptoms. You went to the cave because you was jacked up. You went to the cave because you was depressed. You went to the cave because you was in debt. You went to the cave because you was disconnected. You went to the cave because you was a single mother and had a baby out of wedlock. You went to the cave because you were bankrupt. You went to the cave because you was an adulterer. You went to the cave because you was sleeping with the wrong person. You went to the cave for help. And then while you were there, you got bored and wanted to get out. And now that you're out, you're multiplying the issues that you had. The training was to keep you to a minimum. The training was to help you to get past that thing. But we came out and we started multiplying, and we came out sick, and we came out undelivered. We came out uncovered. We came out unsanctified. You better stay in the cave until God says so. Yes, verse 5. That's where I'm at. That's where I'm at. And actually, I'm almost done with it. Verse 5. And the prophet Gad. Gad bothered me all week long about this. The prophet Gad said to David, "Have I not in the whole? Depart and get thee in the land of Judah." Then David departed, came into the forest of Herath. Now, I learned that Gad, there were a couple Gad, there was the tribe of Gad, but this was the prophet Gad. And Gad was a prophet of God. He wasn't a false prophet. He was, oh, can I say this? Can I just ask, slip this in? Where are the Elijahs at? Where are the ones that saying, "I declare that it shall not rain for the next so many days, so many years"? Where are the Gads at that tell us when to stay in and when to come out? Where is the Elisha, hallelujah, that we see miracles happening? Where are they at? Where is Gad in this generation, in this season? Where is the prophet Gad? I'm looking for you, Gad. I'm listening for you, Gad. Isn't it something how this Gad here, G-A-D, just one letter away from God. I didn't read anywhere that Gad was in the cave either. Hallelujah. Maybe you don't understand where I'm going with that. Sometimes even leaders get tired, and they get tired of hearing bickering, and they get tired of disorder, and they get tired of hurt and people talking about them and abusing them, and they get tired. And even though it's a part of their training also, David was in that cave with the rest of those men because he had escaped his surrogate father trying to kill him. His son was trying to kill him at one point. He had slept with a woman he had no business sleeping with, had her husband killed in war, lost a child. He had gone through some stuff. He had gone through some stuff. So he was in there just like you. Some of you preachers need to understand, you in the cave just like everybody else. It's going to take a Gad that sits outside of the chaos. It's going to take a Gad that isn't feeling the emotions that you are feeling. You got to wait to hear from Gad. You got to wait to hear from God from outside of your own chaos. We make many bad decisions in our temporary chaos, y'all. Leaders that are being people pleasers make bad decisions in temporary chaos because you just want everybody to like you. You want everybody to give you a high five. Listen, a true leader will know that everybody is not going to like you. Matter of fact, they're not all going to agree with your decisions. So if you surround yourself with a bunch of yes people, I'm telling you, you're setting yourself up to fall. You need some people around you that is going to push you, that's going to talk to you like that. Sit down. You need to sit down. You need to study. You need to pray. All these kings had a prophet that was talking to them and telling them what thus saith the Lord. But making decisions in temporary chaos, and I ain't talking about number 45. I ain't talking about you for that matter. But where is God in all of this? Where is God in all of this? It was Gad. It was God who stands on the outside of your chaos that will give instructions when it's time to come out. Ask him, shall I go or should I stay? We don't ask God for nothing. We don't ask him for decision answers in our decisions that we're going through. Usually what we do is we listen to everybody else's advice and we listen to everybody else's supposed wisdom and counseling, and then after it gets all jacked up, then we go to God and say, "God, what do I do now? What do I do now, Andy? What do I do? What do I do in the midst of all this?" And in the he will give you instructions when it's time to come out. In the Message translation, and I end pretty much close to this, Deuteronomy 28, 1 and 2. Deuteronomy 28, verse 1 and 2. And this is the Message translation, so it don't sound like the King James Version. It says, "If you listen obediently to the voice of God, your God, and heartily obey all of his commandments that I command you on this day, God, your God. They repeat that again, your God. I'm not talking about the G-O-D, small G-O-D. I'm talking about the big G-O-D, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the God over the little gods. I'm talking about that God. He repeats it twice. God, your God, will place you on high, high above the nations of the world. How can you see what you need to do unless you're sitting up in heavenly places with God, looking down and seeing what's going on? All these blessings, he said, will come down on you and spread out beyond you because you have responded to the voice of God, your God. Hear me. We sometimes hear God, but we don't respond to the voice. Somebody needs to learn how to respond to his voice. Respond to his voice. Don't act like sometimes my husband be talking and he be just talking and he'll, every now and then he'll check me and he'll say, are you listening to what I'm saying? Because, you know, I'm quiet and I'm just, you know, I take it all in. And sometimes I am doing other things, but I'm hearing every word, but I'm not responding. And so we have to learn how to respond correctly to the voice of God. Yes, God, I hear you. Yes, God, I see you working. Yes, God, I believe you. Yes, God, I trust you. Yes, God, yes, God, yes, God. Respond correctly to the Lord. Hallelujah. There are two important parts to that scripture. Number one, you have to hear the voice of God. Get into a place where you can hear. You're around so much junk and chaos that you can't hear God. The Bible says that in these last days that we'll heap to ourselves itching ears. Yes. And we want to hear what we want to hear. Yes. Somebody come and rub my genie for me. Somebody come and tell me you're good, you're cute, you're all that. I love what you're doing. Don't let nobody stop you. You're the one. You're the boss. You're the, you know, stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. We need to heed to the voice of God, not little g, but big G. And then secondly, obey the instruction. Oh my God, all through the Bible, Noah built the ark based on instruction. King Solomon built a temple. I mean, those were some detailed instructions. We wouldn't even make it through those instructions. We'd be trying to take a shortcut. Well, I think we should have did it this way. I think we should have did maybe it that way. And but that's old school. That's old school. Let me take you to new technology here. We need to hear the instructions of God. If he says go left, go up straight, make a U-turn, come back around, then do exactly that. There is a purpose. There are some times that you take shortcuts. And God is trying to get you around a disaster. He's trying to get you around a big accident about to wait to happen in your life. But we got to take the shortcut because I can't wait. I can't wait. I can't wait. I got to go. I got to go. I got to go. So listen, when it's time to come out, just like there's a time to go in, there's a time to come out. Yes. And according to 1 Samuel 22:5, we will have benefits if we wait and listen to the voice of God. There'll be benefits. He said, and the benefit was, I'm going to enter into Judah. You'll know when it's time to come out. Because when you come out, my feet felt like shouting when I came out the wilderness. My hands felt like clapping when I came out the wilderness. You'll find a place called praise, called Judah. Hallelujah. Somebody, when we come out of the cave, we're getting back to Judah. Hallelujah. In the cave, we learned how to fight. In the cave, we learned how to reposition ourselves. In the cave, we learned how to put one foot in front of the other. In the cave, we learned how to hear the voice of God. In the cave, we were trained. We got our feelings hurt. We were mad. We didn't get our way because we were in training. But when it is time to come out, hallelujah, Judah is on the other side. Judah means praise. Come on, praise him on the other side of through. There's going to be a praise on the other side of all of your problems and your hurts. There's going to be a praise, hallelujah, a praise place on the other side of the cave. Hallelujah. Stay, my child, stay in that place until God Dad, God, Dad calls you out. Don't worry about what other people are saying to you. Oh, you know, you need to get out of there.
That's good.
You need to go. You need to come on out. People tell me, why'd you stay there so long? Because I was in training. Because I was obedient to the voice of God. Because I wanted what God wanted for me. Hallelujah. And it was in the cave. Hallelujah. If David, the cave is good enough for a king, the cave is good enough for me.
That's good.
If the cave is good enough for a mighty warrior, hallelujah. When he's scared, when he's running, then the cave is good enough for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I ain't looking for no promotion in the cave. I ain't looking to move up in the cave. I'm just in the cave trying to get my training, trying to hear the voice of God. I'm training my ears so I'll hear him and not the other people that are around me, because people will talk you out and talk you into so much nonsense. Hallelujah. Well, you know, they said, the prophet said, the deaconess said, the pastor said, but what did God say?
That's right.
What did God say?
That's right.
Hallelujah. Come on and lift your hands and give him glory. Hallelujah. Lift your hands and give him glory. Hallelujah. We just bless the Lord on today. We trust the Lord on today. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord God, for just being here, God. We thank you, Lord God, for not counting it lost, Lord God, to talk to us, to have conversation with us, Lord. Help us to stay right in the midst of that dark place until we are trained to come out, Lord God, so we don't spread the disease and we don't spread our dysfunctions. We don't spread our issues. We don't spread. Help us, Lord God, to be delivered, healed, and set free. God, help us. Heal us, God. Heal us, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. We're gonna pray this we're gonna play this song, and maybe I can get my daughter, even though she might not want to be seen, for her to pray us out of here. Hallelujah. It'd be ridiculous to have such a great gift in the house. Hallelujah. What an honor to have someone that has gone the distance, who's been in the cave. Hallelujah. And is still yet getting her thing. We're going to play Anthony Brown's group therapy, The Benediction. And we're going to ask her to come closer to the thing. If she feels okay about getting in here, I'm okay with that too. But the benediction. You all go with God as she prays. You can stand right here and we'll hear you.
Father God, we thank you, oh God. We bless you, Father, for a day that we've never seen, oh God. We give you the glory, Father God. We open our mouths all over this world and we just say thank you, Father.
Thank you,
we open our mouths, Father. We are intentional to speak well of you, Father. Thank you for being unconditionally in love with us, Father. Thank you for your radical redemption, oh God. I thank you that in the midst of a pandemic, Father God, the righteous continue to win, Father. Thank you that you continue to lift our feet up, Father, that our foot might not strike against a stone, oh God. We thank you, Father God, that as we watch the news, Father, you continue to hide us in the cleft of the rock, Father God. We bless you, Father God, for your keeping power, Father, for your restoring power. We thank you, oh God, for your restoration power, oh God. We bless you for your fire that continues to fall, oh God. We cover, Father, Pastor, Overseer Frida, Father. We cover those under the sound of my voice, oh God, that whatever it is that they're seeking for their week to come, Father, that you would do it today, oh God. Whatever it is, Father, that they're lacking, oh God, we thank you because we know that you plus us always equals the majority, Father. We bless you that even as I'm praying, oh God, you're going into their homes and you're lifting their heads, Father. Your word says, Father, that you are the glory and the lifter of our bowed down heads. And so we thank you, Father, that even as I pray, oh God, you're causing everything upside down to come right side up, Father. We thank you for every prodigal son that will come home this week, Father. Father God. We thank you for every wayward spouse, Father, that will find their way to you, oh God. We thank you for every blood condition that will be washed by your blood, Father God. We thank you for every good report, Father, that comes as a miracle, God. We thank you, and we say that we offer ourselves as the miracle, God. We will be the next miracle, Father. You don't have to look any further, Father. We offer ourselves as tribute for the miracle, Father. Where there is a need today on this live, Father, that you would be it, Father. We know in you that there is no lack, Father. We know, God, that you've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor your seed begging bread. And so, Father, we close this broadcast out just thanking you, Father, just giving your name the glory. God, we know that, Father, there's two things that the enemy cannot come against, oh God, and that would be your word, Father, and your blood, God. So we speak your word over this broadcast, and we begin to smear it in your blood, Father God, that there would be no hindrance, Father, as the word according to Daniel was hindered, Father. There would be no word that would be hindered, Father. We thank you. We decree that each listener this week will pursue, will overtake, and they will recover all, Father. We thank you for listening. We thank you for staying. We thank you for pursuing. We thank you for every time you've left the 99 to find this one, Father God. We give your name the glory, the honor, and we call it as done in the authority of Jesus, who is the only Christ. And together we simply say, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Woo, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
We bless you.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You are mighty to save, Father.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. It's okay to praise him right where
you're
at.
Thank you, Lord.
It's okay to worship right where you're at in your living room. Hallelujah. God deserves the praise.
Thank you, Lord.
He deserves the honor. Hallelujah. And for those of you who may not know Christ as your Savior, hallelujah, today is the day. Just repeat after me and we will leave up out of here. Dear Jesus, I am a sinner and I heard that there was a Savior. I ask, Lord God, that you forgive me of every sin that I have done, every omission, every any type of sin, Lord God, that I have maybe even thought. We ask, Lord God, that you forgive me and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I believe that you died. I believe that you were buried. I believe that after 3 days, that you rose again and that you're sitting on the right hand side of the Father praying for me as I'm praying to you.
Yes, Lord.
So I thank you. Be my friend. Be my guide. Be my mentor and my teacher. Stay with me, Lord God. And I promise to thank you and give testimony of your greatness in my life.
Yes,
in Jesus' name, amen. And if you prayed that prayer, it's as simple as that. You are saved. Now find a church. Stay online. As long as you got to stay online to get that thing. I love you, and I know you love me too because you're here. You showed up for the word that has been in me. I thank God again for Apostle Ebony Williams. Again, 4:30 on the Builders Church website. And then after that, make sure on Tuesday that if you are a girly girl, if you a woman, if you a lady, get on, make sure you get on the teleconference. And but until then, I'll meet you back here next week. I don't know what God has to say, but I know if you show up, he wants to talk to you and he wants to talk to me. God bless you all. Hi, Miss Betty Shaw. God bless you. I love you, ladies. Jackie, as if I've missed you, I'll make sure that I get back on and reply to your comments, but I appreciate you. I love you all. I love you. I love you. I love you. And there's nothing that you could do about it. Nothing that you can do about it. It doesn't matter what our relationship, if I've seen you, if I haven't seen you. I've seen you in the spirit. Hallelujah. And you look in the future, you look a lot better than you do right now. God's going to fix it. God's going to do it. God bless you, Gary Woodson. I'm glad that you've been healing in the healing process. That's right. I declare victory over the stroke in Jesus' name. I love that. You better go ahead and decree and declare that thing. We love you all. You all stay in touch. And I can't wait to meet you all again next week. Make sure, hit like and share. Appreciate it. Bye.